So, since we only have actually not even quite 40 minutes, I just jump into one of the main questions that I have for you guys, and that's when we made the show, when I curated the show, I really wanted to have you in that exhibition because it's about the individual's freedom and freedom of speech, and I was thinking I have to have this Pussy Riot piece, and I'm an art historian, so I really thought that, of course, it's art. But then there were all these issues. Is it really art, or can we just take that video from YouTube that you posted on YouTube on the internet shortly after the event in 2012? Can we show this in this art context? So my question to you is now, how do you feel when you came up the stairs now? How do you feel by seeing the video in a museum, in the National Museum of Oslo, and in this art context? Is this something that you like or that you think is appropriate?
В данный момент, когда я наливала кофе, мне казалось, что это тоже могло быть перформансом в каком-нибудь Европейском музее современного искусства.
Frankly, when I poured some coffee, I also thought that it could be a performance in one of European museums of contemporary art.
Может быть, даже феминистским перформансом, потому что я наливала кофе мужчинам.
Maybe even a feminist performance, because I was pouring coffee for men.
Хорошо.
I felt okay.
Yeah. Они даже не сказали спасибо. Вы даже не сказали спасибо.
And you didn't even say thank you.
Because of coffee.
For the men.
Yeah.
Replica for the men, right?
You
for
didn't coffee. Say thank you. Because they say that it's okay, the woman who
it's
gave them
the
coffee.
Woman. I'm so sorry that I'm so bad at this. I should have done it.
We think it's okay because we are kind of artists. Kind of.
And this whole debate, which is actually also the topic for us today, is it art or is it activism or actionism or the relationship between all these things, political art, performance art?
А как провести черту между этими делами?
We don't feel. How can you clearly draw a line between these things you're referencing?
Yeah, I was just saying you must by now get. Are you getting bored by the question what it is, or are you still interested in figuring it out? Or I mean, you have a very. I saw you all have to go on YouTube and see a talk that they gave at the Frieze Art Fair in New York, only in the beginning of 10th of May, I think, with David Remnick, and where you really referencing. I think we won't have time here today. Referencing all the history, all the art history, both of you. Really, really interesting, and so it is interesting to have all those references, but it's maybe not so interesting to draw a very clear line for you. If have I understood that correctly?
Да, абсолютно фигура. Вообще обычно то, что мы пытаемся сделать, это избавиться от каких-то совершенно простейших оппозиций, которые тебя как раз загоняют, то часто невозможно действовать.
What we usually try to do is try to steer ourselves clear from these maybe simple oppositions, which often make it very difficult to actually act.
Mm. And also, if I, as an art historian, look at like early performance art, 70s performance art, body art, even political or not political, most of these performances we know through images or films. And it seems that these early performance artists like Bruce Nauman, Chris Burden or Valley Expert, all these people already, like you did, thought more not just the live event, but they thought mediation. They thought, how do we get this across? There must be a picture, there must be a video, there must be something that kind of takes up that live event and perpetuates it to our audiences. And that is an idea that is so ingrained in performance art that I thought, well, that's exactly what you're doing. When I see this video that we're showing, that is something that you must have thought of even prior to the performance. So that's such an important part, the video. It's not like a side product, it's kind of
Так естественно, если бы не было видео, нас бы не посадили.
Well, obviously, because there's no, if there would be no media, video, we wouldn't have been in prison.
То есть наши власти, они отреагировали именно на медиапродукт. Следовательно, он является сильной частью.
Because our government reacted to the media products of the whole thing, so it's obviously is the strongest part of it all.
Например, изначально, до того, как они увидели клип, брали комментарии у пресс-секретаря Русской Православной Церкви, и он сказал, что, ну, в общем, ничего такого не произошло сегодня, в храме Христа Спасителя, все по графику, все по распорядку, ничего не было особенного.
So, before the church authorities during that day, when once they still didn't see the video clip, the press secretary of the Russian Orthodox Church, he made a statement saying, well, you know, I don't think anything special happened in the church. Everything is according to the schedule. Everything is okay. Everything is pretty much normal. This was said before they saw the video.
И в тот же день они пригласили в полицию свидетелей того, что было, и все свидетели написали о том, что ничего особенного не произошло, и никаких там чувств не были затронуты. Все уголовное началось после того, как была дана команда сверху, и появилось это в прессе.
And during that same day, they also invited witnesses to the police. The witnesses made statements that nothing especially happened, everything was okay, it's not a public disturbance. So everything started going once the press got started and after the product itself appeared.
Everything criminal stuff.
Yes, all the criminal things.
That is a very interesting point. That is.
Мы пытались доказать суде о том, что существует противоречие между словами людей, которые в один в тот же самый день говорят одно и буквально через неделю говорят ровно противоположное, но нас совершенно не слушали, все наши ходатайства, они отклонялись, ничего этого не было принято судом внимания.
In court we tried to show the contradiction between statements of people once they were given during the day of the action and a week later, but all our appeals were rejected by the court, the court simply was not interested in hearing that.
So it is partly the video that brought you to jail. If you hadn't had posted that video on the internet, then you would have probably.
Да, они прямо говорили в суде об этом. Они прямо говорили об этом в суде.
Yes, and they directly said about that in court.
Но все-таки кажется, что под видео, под медиапродуктом должно быть событие. То есть, условно говоря, в каком-то большом, большем смысле этого могло бы не случиться, если бы, допустим, это было бы в павильоне. Если бы это было в павильоне, если бы это было в декорированном помещении, то, возможно, тоже ничего бы не было, потому что это же касается каких-то более судьбоносных вещей.
So we obviously still, we obviously do feel that if, for example, this event would take place in a specially designed pavilion, in a marketplace, all the afterward repression would never have happened.
So it's a very, very conscious decision that you made then, and also your collaboration with filmmakers. I don't really know if Google's Wife or like an earlier format of Google's Wife already was making that video, or how did your collaboration?
It's Pussy Riot video. It's Pussy Riot video.
It's a Pussy Riot video. But how did your what is your background and the background of your collaboration for the Pussy versus Putin?
Ну, собственно, у нас какие-то были схожие круги общения, просто в России круг современного искусства и особенно такого политического искусства, он очень-очень узок. И в какой-то момент вот мы там встретились в этом кругу с девушками.
Well, we basically had similar circles of where we were hanging out, because in Russia the contemporary art circle is very, it's quite close and not that big, so at one point we basically met the girls.
И это еще было до рождения посирает, и, например, мы там участвовали в перформансе другой группы, но это тоже были политические акции, и я сделал короткий фильм об одной из акций еще до создания Pussy Riot.
And we met them before the birth of Pussy Riot, so we participated also in a work with another collective, but with some of the same people in another political action, and also I created a film, documentary film out of that action, which was done before Pussy Riot.
Потом девушки создали проект Pussy Riot, и, в общем-то, мы продолжили как-то с ними дружить и снимать их и сотрудничать.
So after when the girls created the whole Pussy Riot project, we continued being friends, collaborating, filming them and doing various things together.
И вот на самом деле было так, что просто члены группы Google Spice придумали для нас акцию, еще не Pussy Riot, другую акцию, в ходе которой мы прикидывали семьей дорожного мента, приставали к нему и изображали, что мы являемся семьей, которая пришла на дорогу, чтобы помогать ему брать взятки.
So, in reality, during Vasi is referring to the previous action, which consisted of members of our art collective posing as they actually made thought the members of Google's Wives thought of this action, suggested to us to pose as members of a family, of a police, of a traffic policeman, and to take bribes on the road for the benefit of this traffic policeman, whom we're supposed to approach on the road and come into contact and basically help him to take bribes on the Russian road.
Скажи, что сейчас вот мы занимаемся правозащитной деятельностью, они по-прежнему документируют все, что мы делаем, наши поездки, наши все побивания пока, как первые результаты.
Now, once we started to do this NGO work in our prisoners' rights NGO, Global Rights still collaborate with us, join some trips and document all these things, which involve people beating us up sometimes and various other events.
Yeah, can you tell us a little bit about your new project, the Zona Brava, which means the zone of law? We have already heard and read about it, but maybe I was wondering, how does this new work relate to your overall work, which is artistic slash activist? Is it a continuation, or do you think, well, now this part is over and this part is something new, or is it you feel it's a continuation?
Just one thing I would say, more like zone of justice, not zone of law.
Okay.
I think the meaning is closer to justice.
Okay, good.
Очень здорово. Сначала мы заставили весь мир произнести посирать, теперь мы заставляем весь мир выучить русский язык. Говорит зона права.
And it's very funny. First we tried to make the whole world pronounce посирать, now it's moving to everyone pronouncing zona права.
Did it start in Russian language?
And now they understand.
Еще раз патриотами не называют после этого.
And after that they're not calling us patriots of Russia.
Называют врагами народа.
They call us the enemies of the state.
Да, и наши фотографии висят в Крыму на выходе из вокзала, как фотографии врагов народа.
And our photos are hanged in Crimea, in the exit from the main train station, as photos of the enemies of the state.
Там есть такой большой плакат, на котором изображены политики, оппозиционные политики России, некоторые музыканты и вот мы.
There's like a big billboard from the exit, at the exit of that train station, where photos of opposition politicians, musicians, and us are hanged.
Пятая колонна национал-предателей.
Like the fifth column of national traitors, in sense.
That is really disturbing to hear. How do you self perceive yourself? Are you patriots? Are you patriotic towards your homeland or?
Well, we love our country, obviously.
I was thinking so.
Что касается проекта «Зона права», то понятно, что у него есть какое-то более традиционного правозащитного толка измерения, в ходе которого мы занимаемся бумажками, подаем заявления в суды, в различные надзирающие инстанции. Но там также есть и арт-направление, к которому при всем желании, наверное, вряд ли могли бы избавиться при наших мозгах.
So, obviously, first of all, there's the legal side that we make appeals to the court, deal with various legal documents, go to courts, but obviously with our brains it's impossible to take out the artistic component, it's still there.
По-моему, это, в принципе, интересно появляться и как-то пытаться реализоваться в разных направлениях, так как это расширяет мышление, расширяет для тебя те способы, с помощью которых ты действуешь.
Well, I think it's very interesting to appear in sort of various forms and to do various activities, because it really broadens your brain and broadens your activity and the things you're able to do in life.
Да, например, как-то раз в рамках расширения возможностей нашей активности мы учились говорить по металлу.
So one time during in our previous art collective, during the course of broadening our art activity, or generally our activities, we learned how to weld on metal.
And
in the right English word, like welding, was to cut metal.
Ну ты объясни, что мы делали.
And this was done in order to weld the doors of one right wing of a restaurant in Moscow, which was owned by a right wing TV host. So we welded the doors.
So he couldn't get out, or
so everyone in the restaurant couldn't get out.
Okay.
On Christmas Eve.
That's nice. So could one even go so far and say your entire activity? If it's doing a performance, making a film or video, meeting people, or doing this Zona Prava new project, which is dealing with the situation in prisons today all over the world, that all could be described maybe even as a Gesamtkunstwerk, using that Gesamtkunstwerk, that total work of art that we also know from the Kunstkritik, that we know from you referred to Boris Groys once, you probably know his book.
Господи, такие вопросы мы обычно отвечаем, что мы очень тупенькие, мы просто действуем.
Or is it too big of a word?
Usually these questions we act, we're just very stupid, we just act.
Okay. Makes sense. Because maybe you... you know Borat?
Borat,
yes.
Borat.
Yeah, I love the film, so yes.
It's our hero and role model.
And also a big gesture. So be careful.
Yeah. The great dictator.
Okay. I mean, it makes totally sense that it feels natural for you, whatever you're doing, that you don't really make prior categories before you do something. I think probably nobody who is as active as you are would work that way. And for me, I mean, it's interesting with this Gesamtkunstwerk, but the total work of art, but I also think maybe that would kind of align you with somebody like, even like the Russian Kunstwerkists, like Futurist Theater, and they were also doing all kinds of things, from writing to theater to going out in the street, but of course that was kind of historical avant-garde that was maybe much more, Boris Groy said they really wanted, in the end, power. I don't really know if you want, I mean, to a certain extent you want power, but you probably don't want it.
Ну, если возвращаться к Гройсу, то мы недавно поняли, что Путин просто решил стать другим великим художником после Сталина в России. И, к сожалению, ему это удается сейчас.
Well, if we turn back to Gross, unfortunately, recently we realized that Putin is trying to, right now, be the next great artist in Russia after Stalin. And unfortunately, he's so far successful in doing that.
Mm. Yeah, so he's going to be the big...
В частности, когда мы написали эту мысль у себя в социальной сети, мне пришли такие ответы от провластных ботов, потому что, ну, по крайней мере, его работа очень хорошо продается на российском рынке.
Well, and when I wrote, when we wrote this in our social networks, these pro-government sort of internet trolls, they were constantly writing to me, well, at least his Putin's works sell good on the Russian market.
I heard that Putin just a couple of days ago passed this new legislation in the Duma where he is actually prohibiting the use of four words, the word of the male sex, the word of the female sex, the word of sexual intercourse, and the whore, which are apparently very, very, very vital words in colloquial Russian language. So that is an incredible thing to hear for my ears. And you, in this interview that I saw where I have this information, you said it started out all with this football song that used all this, and it was called Putin is a Dick.
Putin
is a dick,
yes.
And so that actually...
the penalty is 2,500 rubles. That's 50 euro.
50 euro?
Yes, he would be... You'd
be fine now, okay. Mm-hmm. And me too, probably. Yeah, I said it in English, so maybe that doesn't count.
Да, если вы выучите слово...
There's a separate fine for organizers of events. It's much higher. It's like 500 euro.
But that means that basically...
Это вещь большого теоретического стола, круглого, академического. Является ли слово «дик» тоже словом, которое будет наказываться в Российской Федерации? Либо это получается, что на английском языке вы можете материть Путина сколько угодно?
Well, I think this is to be subject of like a serious academic debate in Russia, whether the word, for example, dick has to be also punished, or you can swear in Russian and English as much as you can,
Но
as much as you want.
Непременно нужно составить целый лист аналогов на всех языках, включая китайский, например, и включить все эти слова в перечень того, как данных.
We think there should be like a multi-language list in Russia of all swear words from all languages translated that should be banned.
Media project.
Media.
Website.
So we need that song, because this whole room is actually an artwork by Susan Hiller, where she has collected all kinds of protest songs from back until the Middle Ages to today. It's a great piece, and we have all the songs in that jukebox, so we need that song, put it into the collection so we can listen to it. If it's, maybe it's already in there, but if it's a recent song, then probably not. But yeah, but that is really, I was thinking now it's we only have like 15 minutes left, and maybe that's a good moment where we can open up, because I think we have somebody in the audience. His name is Vadim Dergachev, but he's an activist and a lawyer, and maybe Alexander can say something more, but maybe you can also tell us a little bit more what's happening in Russia right now.
I just want to say, continuing our conversation about the total art, that during the last several years we witnessed the art of horror and sometimes art of absurd and sometimes both, you know. And the chain of laws which are adopted by State Duma, State Parliament, is altogether the art of absurd right now, and maybe it would be art of horror if people would be really punished by using these laws. And it actually reminds me of some Soviet laws which were quite funny, which were more like art of absurd, because as well as I know, nobody was really arrested or suffered because of using these laws. But I recently read some list of prohibited rock groups in Russia, and it's interesting that it's a big list of all kinds of rock groups. They find some strange part of words or strange part of image, and they actually, the Communist Party Committee, which sent these letters to all discotheques, to all clubs with prohibition to use the particular groups, particular bands. And some of them were accused for criticizing Soviet Union just for like one word, like Brezhnev took Afghanistan, you remember Pink Floyd, The Wall, and some of them just for their look. And what was really funny when they write about KISS, you know KISS, right, from the United States, they write fascism, sadism, homosexual. So I think it's like a real, real art of absurd. And whatever is art of absurd right now, and how it was in a way, as many people think, provoked by some radical actions as a reaction of Pussy Riot, but in Dergachev could tell you, because he is now one of the possible victims of this law, because he was accused for just one sentence, as I know, in Facebook or Twitter, but he could tell more about this, how these terrible laws of absurd, art of absurd, as legislation of Russia, could affect our lives.
Yeah. Or maybe we want to have a question from the audience, or even if you...
The last 1.5 to 2 years, the government really got basically insulted by the action which were happening in the PE. We can see this Pussy Riot action triggered that protest. Church, regarding the Second World War, and other things.
Власть в России обозначила некие точки, случаи перехода, за которые она стремится карать. В последнее время российский режим из довольно мягкой диктатуры стремительно перемещается в сторону жесткой диктатуры, похожей на китайскую.
So, the Russian regime has sort of marked out the points that once you cross them, it starts punishing you. And in the recent months, the Russian system is sliding from a sort of a soft dictatorship to more of something like a child, like the Chinese system. For example, recently a new legislation was adopted which says that the critique of the Crimea annexation is extremism, and for voicing that critique you can get up to 4 years in prison. Much says the whole Russian service of BBC should be imprisoned then.
Since we... I was just thinking maybe we can...
To tell about his own case, because I have seen a lot of moments personally in demonstrations and different videos how this guy was really successful of proving that to arrest people in this very moment is not legal, especially in provincial cities where police is not that kind of brutal. He really released a lot of people just from police cars, explaining police people in very aggressive way that they violate
I was just promising the audience to also be able to, maybe there's some who really have a very, very quick question, because we have to... Okay, if please.
So after the parliament elections of 2011, a very big number of people started to take part in mass demonstrations. Now, I realize that most of the people do not have an idea how to act and behave with the police. And I started to take part in these actions and to give an example by myself how to resist police and how to act with them, being based on the Russian laws, using the Russian laws, how to correctly behave and communicate with the police.
This is really, really interesting for us who don't know so many details. But I was just thinking, since we have to wrap up in a couple of minutes, I was just thinking if the audience, who might, many have maybe come to really have a question. There's one question.
Я только хотел спросить, каким образом бывших политзаключенных относятся к вам? Я думаю о политзаключенных из советского эра.
Question is how political prisoners of Soviet era, the old political prisoners, how they, what's their attitude towards this guy?
Мы дружим с некоторыми из них. Например, Александр Подробейник, наш близкий друг, он защищал меня в суде, когда я судилась в тюремной администрации.
Well, we're friends with some of them. For example, Alexander Podrobinik, our close friend and a former political prisoner in the Soviet Union in the 1980s. He was one of my defendants in court while I was in prison.
More questions? There's a question.
What are your thoughts on Putin's annexation of the Crimea half island and his involvement in Crimea?
А что можно сказать?
That is, well, what can you say?
Okay. Okay.
There's a good word for it for translate this in Russian. You know, it's a word. It's difficult to translate. It's sort of a word.
Without getting.
That is used when hooligans take your mobile phone in a dark side street at night. It's like, you know, in English, if anyone knows English good, it's in Great Britain, they have the word to nick. He nicked it. He nicked my purse. They don't use it in America. So it's sort of a hooligan's word to take something by force, your mobile phone, for example.
Зато теперь понятно, кого действительно надо за хулиганство сажать.
But now it's that it's, so that it's clear who has to be really imprisoned for hooliganism. Mm-hmm.
I actually had a question for Vasily. I noticed this film has a lot of material that the wider public, I'm assuming, hasn't seen, and you actually spent a lot of attention on the crowd and you showed the Orthodox protest, which I haven't seen in the Western press, and I haven't seen the screen before. Can you talk a little bit about how you decide? You stop at the trial, which is where most people kind of picked up. So can you talk a little bit about how you decided to structure the film?
Но основная задача, которую мы ставили относительно структуры и вообще всего, что касается художественной стороны фильма, мы хотели показать, как бы, каково это быть внутри акции прямого действия.
Well, the main idea that we set for ourselves for the structure of the film is how it's to show how it's like to be inside of a direct action.
Поэтому мы не использовали там многих классических приемов документального кино, как интервью, потому что мы решили, что это будет как бы отстранять немножко зрителя. Мы хотели сделать его максимально вовлеченным.
So this is why we didn't use some of the classical formal methods of documentary cinema like interview, because we thought that the use of interviews would sort of distance the viewer from what is happening.
Ну и, конечно, на структуру повлияли какие-то формальные вещи. Например, мы не показывали куски, где есть девушки, которые еще как бы неизвестны, которые анонимны, мы не могли показывать их лица.
Well, and obviously some, for example, formal things relating to the things that were going on at that time also influence the structure of the film. For example, we couldn't show the faces of the girls from Pussy Riot that were still anonymous, and that and their faces could not be shown.
Do you think that in our lifetime we will be able to experience a Russia free of oppression and with a proper freedom of speech?
That's a good last question.
Мы верим еще, поэтому мы живем, поэтому мы действуем. То, что он вложил веру, как ни странно, это годы, проведенные за решеткой. Потому что многие люди, которые, казалось бы, максимально далеки от политики, на деле несут в себе достаточно большой оппозиционный заряд. Просто они не знают, как его выразить. Они понимают, что сейчас это очень опасно. Но в какой-то момент все может поменяться, и эти настроения у них никто не отнимет.
Well, obviously, we still live, we still act, we still do things, and we hope that things will change. What gives hope is that a big number of people really have sort of opposition notions inside them, and they do not know yet how to show them. So, but these notions and these opinions cannot be taken away, so we hope this will someday be acted out.
Вообще, мне кажется, каждый видит то, что хочет видеть. И когда мы смотрим на Россию, мы смотрим на тех людей, которые являются по-настоящему свободными, так как они ставят на карту свое положение и действуют.
Well, I think everyone basically looking at Russia sees what he wants to see. When we look at the country, we see people who act and who put everything they can to in order to act out and to live out their own fights that they have.
Да. И довольно часто говорим, и мне кажется, это действительно как-то очень важно понять для стран Запада, не нужно ассоциировать Россию с Путиным.
And we often say, and this is very important to understand for people in the West, it is important not to associate Russia with Putin.
Потому что таким образом вы ему помогаете.
Because in this way you are helping him by associating the country.
Thank you. I think these are very nice last words. I want to thank you all of you for coming.